Okay, Madam Clerk, let's get started. I want to call to order the meeting of the Long Beach City Council. Roll call, please.
Councilwoman Zendejas.
Present.
Vice Mayor Allen.
Present.
Councilmember Duggan.
Here.
Councilmember Supranaw.
Here.
Councilwoman Kerr.
Here.
Councilwoman Sorrow.
Present.
Councilmember Yaranga.
Presente.
Mayor Richardson.
I am here.
We have a quorum.
Thank you. We'll start with Pledge of Allegiance led by Councilmember Roberto Yaranga.
I want to thank everybody for being here this evening. We have a long meeting, a lot of discussion to be had. So let's have a moment of silence to please give us the strength to survive tonight. Thank you very much. Please stand if you are able and join me in the flag salute. Hand over your heart. Ready to begin. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Thank you very much for your indulgence.
All right. Thank you. So two members of our body, Council Members Ricks Odie and Councilman Austin, will be absent tonight. Let's start off. Is there a report out from closed session?
Thank you very much, Mayor. We have no report from closed session.
All right. Thank you. So we have one presentation, then we'll handle consent, and then we have our general public comment. Then we go into our hearings. I believe we have, two hearings, and then we'll go on with the rest of the agenda. So let's start with the presentation on utility department update on winter gas pricing.
Thank you. Can we get the presentation up, please? Trust me, this is going to be good news. I apologize for this.
We'll just give another minute or so while they queue up the presentation. I mean, you can.
So they're having some difficulty pulling it up in the back. They need a little bit of time if we can move on to something and come back to this.
Okay. All right. So we'll come back to the presentation. Let's move through a few items on the agenda. Let's start with consent calendar. There's a request.
Sir, they got it up.
We got it. All right. Fantastic. Let's have our presentation.
So thank you very much, Mayor and City Council. As you recall, last winter we had very extreme high gas prices. And so what we wanted to do tonight was talk to you about what we've been doing since January to correct this. So if you remember the past few years, we've had very low gas prices, very low gas bills, and happy times. But then last winter started in November, December, the prices started creeping up. And then in January 2023, the price of gas skyrocketed. We took over as the combined utility department on January 3rd, the first business day of the new year. And that is, just by coincidence, that's when the prices skyrocketed. So what happened was, for the average customer in Long Beach, you had in January 2022, the cost of gas, which is passed through to the customer, was only $61. And then in January 23, it quadrupled up to $244 for that one line item on the bill. So since January, what the Long Beach Utilities Department has been doing is we've been trying to take aggressive actions to correct that and protect our customers. So, it just disappeared. I'll keep going. Let me look at my notes, because I don't have the slide presentation. So one of the first things that we did was we started aggressively tackling our storage. So we contract with Southern California Gas Company to store gas. We buy the gas when it's less expensive during the summer months, when demand is low, store it in underground storage fields, and then in the winter when prices are high because the demand is increased, we withdraw that and save money for our customers. Then on top of that, we have to import about 90% of our gas supply from out of state, and so we use interstate pipeline. And so what we did was we negotiated new receipt points on those pipelines to bring gas into California. And so what we did was we got the most favorable gas receipt points on those pipelines, and that allows us access to the cheapest gas supplies and with the firmest reliability. Then in January, when we took over, the first thing we did was we contacted the state of California because we buy natural gas from them. And under the contract, there's a little known clause that allows us to reject their gas if it's too expensive. And so we notified the state of California that we would not be buying their gas in January of last year because the price was around $47 a unit. And we had gas and storage at $7 a unit. And that action alone saved our customers about $10 million just in the month of January alone. We also renegotiated contracts to bring gas to California, and we're saving our customers about $2 million a year from that action. And then the last one is one I really want to point out is we reinstituted the practice of hedging the price of natural gas. So with price hedging, what we're trying to do is protect our customers by transferring the market risk for high prices to a third party. And that protects our customers and prevents them from the vulnerability that we had experienced in January of last year. And the cost of gas we've hedged is for the next three winters. So as you know, winter is when it's cold, and that's when natural gas bills are the highest. And those are the months that we hedge the price of natural gas to protect our customers. And with this action, our customers in Long Beach are better protected with price protection, price stability, than any other gas customers in the whole state of California. And so how did we do that first month? The first month was the month of November, last month. And the first month, what happened was we had the lowest gas bills in California. We were 16% less than what was paid by customers of SoCalGas. 35% less than paid by customers of San Diego, 32% less than paid by customers in Northern California to PG&E, and 13% less than paid by Long Beach residents a year ago. So it was a huge success, and we were very proud of that. What I want to do is take a moment and thank the mayor and the city council for the actions they took last winter for the financial assistance and also the city manager. We provide our customers millions of dollars in financial assistance to soften the blow of the high gas prices. I also want to thank my Board of Utility Commissioners for the work that they did on this and allowed us the flexibility to do these contracts. And I'd like to introduce a couple members of my team, Tony Foster and Dennis Burke. They've worked on this since last January to make this work. So what can customers expect this coming winter? For the month of January, last year, the average residential price was $313. This coming January, we expect with this price hedging, the average bill to the Long Beach resident will be $108, which is down 65% and a cost savings of over $200 for the average residential customer. And it's not working still. So I just want to say that with this action, our customers can sleep with a smile this winter and be confident that they will not face what they faced last winter. And that concludes my report. Thank you.
All right. It's okay. Gas bill 65% lower than last year is something worth applause. So thank you so much for your incredible work in getting that done. And I'll tell you, I was just talking with Councilmember Kerr and talking with the city attorney about just like the different, you know, things we had to address, like coming right off of the inauguration and state of the city last year. This was the first thing we got hit with. It was like triple gas prices. What are we going to do? So it feels good going into the season, having learned and prepared last year for this season. I think our ratepayers and our residents are going to be glad that we had that foresight to engage early on. So thank you so much. And the screen is all working now. So thank you. That's our presentation. We have, okay. Yeah, please. Sorry, I don't have the speakers teed up.
It's not queued up. Okay. Just a quick question. Thank you so much to you and your team for all the work you've done over the last 12 months. We know that there are challenges and have been challenges for ratepayers trying to pay their bill over the last couple of weeks. Wondering if you could just remind everyone kind of how that is working in terms of shutoffs or lack of shutoffs and payments and just what the last couple of weeks will look like and what they can expect moving forward to continue to rest easy.
Well, I have good news on that standpoint also. Today we learned that the billing system is back up and the payment system is back up also. So we're back to normal in terms going forward. Customers that did not receive a bill, they should receive a bill the next few days. They do not have to worry about late fees. We have suspended late fees. We've suspended utility shutoff, so they don't have to worry about that. So we will work with any customer that faces any problems with that.
Great, thanks for the clarification.
Sorry, this thing isn't working. Any additional comments from the council? All right, seeing none, thank you so much for the presentation.
Thank you.
All right, and we're gonna get this word out to our ratepayers, right? Fantastic, they need to know. Thank you. All right, let's go to the consent calendar, items 21 through 26, please. Okay, and there's a request to pull item 13. We're gonna hold that over and handle that next. Okay, it's been moved by Councilman Uranga, second by Councilmember Kerr. Is there any public comment on consent? I see one, Alyssa Gutierrez. Going once, going twice. Is that Alyssa over there? Okay. Members, please cast your vote.
Motion is carried.
Thank you. We'll now hear item 13, please.
Report from Economic Development, recommendation to authorize city manager to execute all documents necessary to amend the contract for the Long Beach Pledge Program with the Fund for Guaranteed Income for a total of $612,915 and contract with California State University of Long Beach Research Foundation of Long Beach, California for the Long Beach Pledge Program for a total revised contract amount of $657,308 citywide.
Thank you. This is good news, and we'll talk more about it publicly tomorrow, but we're expanding the guaranteed income pilot to 200 additional families, expanding from just Central into West and into North Long Beach. Let's have a brief staff report, then we'll hear from the council.
Thank you very much, Mr. Mayor. Bo Martinez will give the staff report.
Thank you, City Manager Modica. Bo Martinez, Director of Economic Development, Mayor and City Council. We're excited to expand the Long Beach Pledge Program. And as the mayor said, you know, we're expanding it to 200 families over which will receive $500 monthly for 1 year. And the program will, you know, continue to be administered by F4GI. And then we'll also be a partnership with CSULB has our strong partners for the program. And they'll be designing and conduct research study to illuminate the needs of some of the residents in the most vulnerable communities and how this program is able to impact the participants' lives. As we've done our initial look and research with CSULB on the program, we saw that a lot of the residents that were part of this program are really having housing insecure challenges. And we really feel that the expansion of this program will continue to help those participants as well as new families that come into the program to hopefully get them more in a better position to have secure housing and really provide them more income opportunity as they grow and try to stabilize their families. And so we're really excited about having this additional $1.2 million to fund the program and continue it going forward.
All right, thank you. Councilmember Sorrow.
Yes, thanks, Mayor, and thank you to the Economic Development team for your hard work on this. I'm just so thrilled that the City of Long Beach is piloting this program. Largely, it falls in the 90813, which is in my district, as well as District 1 and a few others as well. And I just wanted to make sure to raise this and pull it out because of how important it is that we were able to find additional funding to support more families. Could you share a total number in addition to this 200, how many it's going to support?
So with this new additional of $1.2 million funding, it'll support an additional 200 families.
Yes, but in total, in the whole program, how many will it, with this 200?
So a total of 450 families.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you, Vice Mayor Allen.
Yeah, I just extending this to 200 more families, which are typically our most vulnerable families in the city, is just incredible. So I support this completely.
Thank you. Again, this is all good news. We're able to expand beyond 90813 into West, into North Long Beach. So we'll be able to continue to see this pilot, and I look forward to seeing what the data comes back and tells us. Thank you so much. Is there any public comment here? Seeing no public comment, members, please cast your vote.
Motion is carried.
Thank you. We'll now go to general public comment. So I'll queue up the... Okay, I see it now. All right, we have 10 members of the public signed up to speak. Alana Powell, Fatima Solis, Katrina King, Michael Edelman, Carlos Ovalle, Lily Montero, Dalal Al-Said, Shannon Dosky, Marshall Blasovsky, and Farah Bartlett. If you heard your name, please come to the front. Is Alana here? Alana going once. Wave a hand if you're here, Alana. All right, if you heard your name, please come to the front. Again, Alana is first, then Fatima, then Katrina. Thank you. You have the floor.
Hello, and thank you so much. Thank you for this opportunity. My name is Alana, and I am a local here in downtown Long Beach. I moved here right off of Pine Avenue last January, and after moving here, I was searching for a sense of community. And at Anna's Joint, I found it. They're one of the only local restaurants that I personally feel is continuously active and involved with our community. From organizing community events to hosting local pop-up markets, Anna's Joint involves the local community whenever it's possible. To those who frequent, they bring a sense of family and comfortability that is unlike anything I've ever felt in another restaurant. Anna's has been a safe space for me personally. I am a business owner myself, so I like to take my laptop and work from Anna's Joint to get out of my little apartment. As a woman, there are no other locations off Pine Avenue I personally feel comfortable working at or frequenting, especially with my laptop and other expensive equipment in hand. With this being said, I would be absolutely devastated if Anna's Joint was to move locations and close the Pine Avenue location. They offer a quiet, safe space and environment, a supportive community, and I'm afraid if they leave, Pine Avenue will feel desolate and stagnant for us locals. I would like to thank you again so much for listening to all of us and considering our stories and about how much Anna's Joint has been a positive impact for me personally and for our community. Thank you.
Thank you. Next we have Fatima.
Yes.
After Fatima is Katrina, then Michael.
Hello, ladies and gentlemen of the City Council. Thank you for allowing me to speak with you today. I'm Fatima Solis, a proud resident of Long Beach for the last 7 years. After spending 6 years in the East Village, I moved to downtown in Long Beach this July. Today, I'm here not just as a resident, but a passionate supporter of our local community, urging you to preserve a crucial spot that has become a heartbeat of our neighborhood and a joint. I represent numerous residents, young and old, who have found solace, camaraderie, and a true sense of community within the walls of Anna's, a place that has evolved into more than just a place to eat and drink. It's a safe haven where individuals from diverse walks of life come together to share stories, build connections, and form lasting friendships. Anna's has become the epicenter of our downtown community, a space where we can escape the hustle of daily life and unite as neighbors. It's not merely a bar, it stands as a living testament to the resilience and strength of our community bonds. The bartenders and staff whom we've grown to know and love are more than mere servers and sandwich makers. They're our extended family. In a world that often feels disconnected, the staff at this establishment has fostered an environment where everyone is welcome with open arms. They care about more than just pouring drinks and making sandwiches. They genuinely care about our emotional well-being. They check in on us during our bad days, celebrate us during good times, and offer a listening ear when life throws challenges our way. Just last week, a homeless woman walked in need of a drink. Without hesitation, the bartender, Michael Jude, treated her with the same kindness and respect afforded to any other patron, providing her with a refreshing beverage before she continued on her way. My best friend, Natalie, who just moved to Long Beach after being in Chicago for 2 years, shared that after attending Anna's for the first time, nervous to meet new people and start a new life, she met so many people and felt instantly part of the community. These incidents are a testament to the inclusive and caring atmosphere fostered by the staff, a quality that sets Anna's apart from the rest. I'm standing before you not only to celebrate the memories created within these walls, but to earnestly request your support in preserving this essential community hub. I understand the importance of regulations and compliance, but I believe there must be a way to find common ground, allowing Anna's to continue serving as a pillar of our community. Together, I'd like to work towards a resolution that not only supports local businesses, but also recognizes the invaluable role Anna's plays in fostering a true sense of community. By doing so, we can ensure the heart of downtown continues to be strong, sustaining the vitality of relationships and connections nurtured within the walls of this cherished bar. Anna's is a community builder first and business second. Thank you for your time.
Thank you. Next speaker is Katrina. After Katrina is Shannon. After it's Michael, then Carlos. Katrina, Michael, Carlos.
I'm here today as a deeply concerned homeowner, not only in the Crest Building, but also a resident of downtown Long Beach. And as you can see, I brought some friends with me from Anna's Joint as well. We're here to request your clemency and support to broker some form of a compromise to keep Anna's open at the corner in Fifth of Pine, and to start acting as an ally rather than an adversary to this small business that is so critical to the revitalization of the North Pine District. There's clear opportunity here for cooler heads to prevail on all sides, because let me be clear here, the real losers are the community, and we're your constituents, and we're Anna's loyal customers. If a quarter of what I've heard is true, then it's clear that they have not been given a level playing field in opening their business. Anna's Joint has become the archstone of both the revitalization of downtown Long Beach and specifically the North Pine District, as well as the epicenter of our local community downtown. The people that have come here today to support Anna's are not a bunch of hooligans. We're professionals, we're lawyers, we're doctors. I'm a tech executive, but most importantly, a lot of us are homeowners in the downtown area of Long Beach. We've made investments in downtown Long Beach. Anna's Joint is probably the quaintest, quietest, and cleanest, safest bar in downtown. I invite each and every one of you to visit. I will personally buy you a drink and a sandwich if you're willing to come down and see what is at risk here. If Anna's is to close, I fear as a property owner of downtown Long Beach that there will be a domino effect on North Pine. Many of the new businesses that have recently opened have been brought there by the vibrance that Anna's has created, and they will be likely to fail, reverting the downtown area to a homeless encampment and a ghost town. This will have a disastrous effect on all of our property values. If Anna's is to close, it will deprive us all of a safe space to gather. It will deprive a group of kind and caring people that are here today of their employment, and it will deprive the city of Long Beach of an effective downtown revitalization, one that is finally beginning to work. We're your constituents. The fact that so many people have gathered here today to voice their support for Anna's and to beg for your action should act as a testament to how many lives this wonderful establishment has touched. But it should also act as warning, because all of you are up for re-election in 3 months. If Anna's is to fail, we will... If Anna's is to fail, we'll consider this council hostile to the improvement of our city, hostile to our property investments, and hostile to our downtown community. We will work tirelessly to engineer wholesale turnover of this council, even if it means canvassing door to door on the behalf of each and one, every one of your leading contenders in the polls. And we will unseat every single one of you. Or you can take action, stand up for downtown Long Beach, and help us save Anna's. We're not messing around. This is not a drill.
Thank you. Next is Michael. After Michael is Carlos. After Carlos is Lily.
Good evening, City Council, Mayor. I'm Michael Adelman. I live in Long Beach. I've been here 15, 20 years. I forget what. I am a bartender at Anna's Joint. And you already have people here telling you what great community we've built there. And it's really part of my job to, you know, we've got that great space with the big open windows. I like people walking by to see friendly faces in there. And, you know, even if you're not a customer, everyone walking by sees what we've built and that it's a comfortable, safe place. And so you've heard people talk about the community already and a little bit about the jobs, you know, where you're employing a dozen or so people at Anna's Joint. But not just that, indirectly, we specialize in local beer. The amount of beer I sell from Long Beach Beer Lab, Ambitious up in Bixby Knolls, Trademark on Anaheim, and other ones, if we are allowed to get swept under in this, I don't really understand the struggle between the city and ownership and the alcohol beverage control, but I'm imploring you to step in, to intervene in some way, any way you can, to save really what is one of the only things going. Like, once you get north of Hamburger Mary's, there's nothing going on. And we're also, like, the only not insane loud place going on. Yeah, we have music some nights, but I'm always talking to my musicians, making sure we could still have a conversation level. We've never had the police called for any sort of fight or disturbance. We're just a place for people to get some food and a drink and talk to their neighbors and meet their neighbors. The number of times I've introduced people in front of my bar who had never met but live on the same floor in the same building. And now, over the course of the last year, they've become a community, not just neighbors, but a community. And I just really fear, without Anna's Joint there, what's going to be there? Another empty storefront on Pine Street? I mean, we just have so many of those. Anyway, I'm just asking for your help somehow in whatever you can do to intervene on behalf of Anna's Joint. Thank you.
Thank you for your testimony. Next is Carlos Avalle.
Free Palestine. Yeah! I am here as a longtime Long Beach resident, but I am also here as a native of Central America, a victim of U.S. imperialism abroad, and hence my solidarity with the Palestinian people. Many of you have said that you won't sign a ceasefire proclamation because genocide and ethnic cleansing are a federal issue. I find that incredibly disingenuous and hypocritical. Long Beach has taken action and issued statements on many federal issues. Didn't you take a valiant stance on the rights to abortion? Didn't you budget funds for the defense of undocumented immigrants? Didn't you, ironically, convert the convention center into a detention center for refugee children separated from their parents at the border? Didn't the LBPD, under your watch, illegally share data with ICE? Didn't you illuminate our civic buildings the color of the Ukrainian flag right after the Russia invaded? And didn't you illuminate the buildings the color of the Israeli flag right after Hamas invaded? I'm going to guess that you don't want to piss off the former Mayor Robert Garcia, congressman, whom you all support, because he takes a pro-colonialist, anti-Palestinian stance, because AIPAC, the Israeli lobby, invested more in his campaign than the next four investors put together. I'm going to guess you support his call to end attacks on Hamas, by Hamas on Israel, but not the more numerous and bloody attacks on Palestinians by Israel for 80 years. I'm going to guess you support his statement, ignorant and fascist as it is, that Israel has a right to defend itself, but Palestinians do not? I'm going to guess that you support his call for the release of 200-and-something Israeli hostages, but not the 10,000 Palestinians held in Israeli prisons, including non-fighters, women and children, and many without trial and without even charges. So I want to know what keeps you from supporting the immediate ceasefire. We've already established that you're willing and able to opine on issues that you can't legislate. We know you. I know you won't answer my question, certainly not in public, where you will be on the record. What are you afraid of? The only people whose opinions you need to be concerned about are your constituents, everybody behind me, not your corporate sponsors, not foreign lobbyists, not Washington, D.C. Palestinians.
Sir,
please stand with us and
Thank
support
you,
our Palestinian brothers.
Thank you, Lily. Lily, you're up next. The election's in March. All right, Lily, you're up next.
Can you guys hear me okay?
We can hear you. Thank you.
All right. Hello, my name is Lily Montero. I'm a resident here in Long Beach, and I'm here asking that City Council call for an immediate ceasefire in Gaza. Yeah. I met my best friend, Dalal Al-Sayed, in 2007 when we were both in the third grade. It was early in the morning, and we were lining up for class when she approached me. She was kind and bright, and when it was time for me to move again, I was devastated. And then, of course, she convinced her mom to let her get a Facebook. Dalal is the first and only friend I've been able to keep for an extended period of time. We've been best friends now for 16 years, and you can imagine that we have a pretty distinct dynamic. We have always thought of ourselves as the same, but different, and we even have a tattoo for this. Dalal says things in the nicest way possible, and I say things in the most brutally nicest way possible. Dalal says, I'm sorry a lot, and I say, why do you keep apologizing? You have nothing to apologize for. Please stop apologizing. Anyways, we have a lot in common. One of the unfortunate things that we have in common is that struggle is our birthright. In 2020, I was sick, not with COVID, but with grief. George Floyd was killed, and I couldn't help but feel it. And Floyd, and Breonna Taylor, and Tamir Rice, I saw my father, my sister, my nieces, my nephews. I couldn't eat, and I couldn't sleep, and I suffered panic attacks frequently. Since October 7th, I have seen Dalal suffer a similar grief as her people in Gaza are slaughtered by the Israeli occupation. She finds it hard to get up every morning. And at meals, she tells me to excuse her lack of appetite. And she dissociates in the middle of conversation. As her best friend, I cannot help but to feel the grief too. In every man, woman, and child I have seen blown to bits in the last 2 months, I see my father, my sister, my nieces, my nephews, my grandparents, my great-grandparents too. I see them in every single body pulled from the rubble. Mayor Rex Richardson, at the last meeting I was at, you asked that we all remember that we are neighbors. Today I ask that you remember to be a friend. Call for a special session and call for a ceasefire. It is well within your power to do so.
Thank you. Next is Dalal.
As the community continues to mobilize more and more each day, we invite you to join us as our representatives in demanding justice for Palestinians and oppressed people everywhere. Not adding this to the agenda would be akin to normalizing genocide and condoning the murder of thousands more civilians. My name is Dalal, and I am Palestinian. My dad was born in Gaza, but my family was from a village nearby called El Masmia. See, in 1948, during the Nakba, which means catastrophe, my grandparents' village was destroyed, and they were forcibly displaced to the Gaza Strip. About half of the population in Gaza are also Palestinians who were displaced from other parts of Palestine. And I just want to remind everyone, what has been happening is not recent. It did not start on October 7th. This has been going on for over 75 years. Since October 7th, we have witnessed the murder of over 20,000 Palestinians, 8,000 plus of those being children. And as we are expecting this number to rise as people continue to pull their loved ones out from the rubble. An immediate ceasefire is necessary to the end of the daily massacres of Palestinians and the further destruction of civilian infrastructure, including residential buildings, hospitals, schools, mosques, and churches. This is not self-defense. This is an attack on civilians, and this is the act of trying to wipe out the Palestinian people. And what we are witnessing is not a war on Gaza alone. It is a war on all Palestinians, and again, has been ongoing for 75 years. Representatives, we know that the public stands with the Palestinian people and are demanding a ceasefire in Gaza. This is evident by the millions, if not billions, who have been taking the streets globally in mass demonstrations, the thousands of students who have participated in student walkouts in high schools and on university and college campuses. I also want to stress that this resolution is directly connected to local issues, such as U.S. and federal spending on militarism and police takes directly away from our community needs, causing more violence against our people here and back home in Palestine. Long Beach and cities across the country cannot solve the pressing problems of homelessness and crime, yet our federal government gives $3 billion to Israel every year out of our tax dollars. And Biden has been giving $14 billion more since October 7th. We need to add a permanent ceasefire to the agenda. We need to add a permanent ceasefire in Gaza to the agenda, and it is really overdue. A four-day humanitarian pause is not humanitarian in any way. And specifically, these past 48 hours has been more intense, and we cannot continue to go on as if nothing is happening. If you support any movement, whether it's Black Lives Matter, women's rights, LGBTQ rights, the civil rights movement, if you stand for human rights, you need to care about the Palestinian movement. As re-election comes in the upcoming months, we want to vote for people who truly represent us. So you continuing to ignore us shows who you are representing. And just as we are here today, we'll be coming.
Thank you for your testimony. Thank you. Our next speaker. Next speaker is Shannon.
Hello, my name is Shannon Paskey, and I am a Long Beach resident, an elementary school teacher, an active member in my union, and a concerned voter. My husband and I have two children who attended preschool at the Alpert Jewish Community Center, and we have been dues-paying members for about 20 years. I am here today to call on the Long Beach City Council to take a clear stance against the violence that is currently happening in Gaza. There is a saying, never again, that is associated with the genocide of Jewish people by the Nazis. It is a saying that means we should learn the lessons of the Holocaust. We should never allow an entire group of people to be scapegoated, dehumanized, and killed. It is clear to me as a Jewish person and as a student of history that what is happening to Palestinian civilians is a genocide. Amen. It is horrifying to know that the bombs and missiles being dropped on women and children are paid for with my tax dollars. Because of this, I believe that Americans have not only a right but a duty to speak out against this situation. Some people think support for Palestinians amounts to anti-Semitism, but I know better. Standing up for the persecuted is a Jewish value, one that I was raised with. In fact, it is the reason I am speaking out today. Although as city government officials, you may believe you have little to say in this matter, I know that the only way things will change is for leaders to have the courage to speak out. Most citizens recognize that war and violence will not solve the problems in Israel and want the suffering to end. Those who represent us should not sit silently on the sidelines while atrocious acts of violence are being committed in the country that was founded on the idea of being a safe haven for the oppressed. It is too late to save the lives of more than 15,000 innocent children and adults who have been slaughtered in this terrible conflict. But it is not too late to prevent further death and destruction. We need leaders at every level to show what righteousness and integrity look like, to publicly condemn the violence and to work toward a peace in Israel. I implore you to be those leaders for your Long Beach constituents and call for a ceasefire now.
Thank you. Marshall.
Hi, I'm Marshall Blasovsky, and I'm a Jewish American. I live in the 2nd District. I used to live up in Megan Kerr's district, but I moved. And I know that you received a letter from the Equity and Human Relations Commission calling for a ceasefire. And this is very important, because we want the city council to address this issue and also ask our congressperson, Robert Garcia, to take a position for a ceasefire, because that is really what we're going to need. So I'm just here to just talk about that. What's happened in Israel, the horror of the October 7th killing of Israelis the Israelis have a right to defend their country, but on the other hand, they've gone way too far. This is definitely a case, if you look on the internet, you look on YouTube, it's a case of genocide. It's genocide against the Palestinian people. It's not going after Hamas. You're never going to get, how many guerrilla warfares have we been involved in? Afghanistan, Vietnam, by killing the population, you're never going to kill a revolution, a change. You've got to give the people of Palestine a place to live. You've got to give them equal rights. And then one of the things I'm running out of time. I've been called a self-hating Jew by some of my friends, and I just want to read something from, this is from Aaron Littman, a father of Aria, who was murdered at the music festival on October 7th. And he said, the hands of the Israeli government and its leader are covered in blood. The prime minister insists on not taking any responsibility for this failure. Therefore, I can no longer remain silent. Littman continued, he accuses the government and its leader of harming the highest values of the state of Israel, equality and democracy, in order to promote dictatorial messianic policy that led to real harm to the lives and safety of residents of Israel. Every day the government remains in office costs lives, and it costs lives of Palestinians, and it also costs lives of Israelis. So thank you very much for allowing me to speak.
Thank you, Marshall.
All right, our final speaker is Farah Bartlett. Is there a Farah here? Is there a Farah?
Good evening. My name is Farah. My name is Farah Bartlett, and I address you today as a Long Beach resident, a Cal State Long Beach alumni, and a proud Muslim queer woman. And as of today, actually about 2 hours ago, after a decade in this country, I became an American citizen. I relocated to Long Beach in 2020. Drawn by the city's reputation for inclusivity, diversity, and acceptance. While my experience within the community has largely reflected these values, it deeply concerns me that the city council has not been responsive to the impassioned pleas of its residents, who have gathered in masses expressing their concerns with their voices, their cafes, and poignant cries. Community member and friend of mine, Tanya, have been organizing rallies, protests, and community events in Long Beach with incredible turnouts in the hundreds. People of all ethnicities, religions, with a shared plea, ceasefire now. One of the things I got asked today during my civics exam was how can an American participate in democracy? And that would be by bringing an elected official a concern. So in that same breath, I asked that you, City Council, and Mayor Rex, respect our concerns. How can any country in the world right now call themselves a democracy? The USA is not a democracy. Otherwise, they would listen to their people. Yeah. Millions of people are marching and protesting and writing to the senators and Congress people and council people right now. The streets are full of people in anguish and heavy hearts. There has never been an issue that has united the people of the world more. A democracy listens to what a majority of the people want. In this age of social media, we are witnessing the harrowing events unfolding in Palestine in real time. Videos of babies dying under the rubble, and incubators being turned off, and fathers carrying their dead babies and bodies and being thrown into mass burials have flooded our screens. And it's disconcerting to think that members of this council have likely seen the same footage, yet remain silent. Seemingly unaffected in their ability to sleep peacefully without making a public statement in support of Palestine and against genocide. And Mayor, I know that you follow Sean Smith and see this footage every day. I pose a straightforward question. Do Palestinians and Muslim voices matter to you? Do our rights hold significance and do our votes carry weight? Palestinians, Arabs, and the Muslim community are experiencing hate crimes, and the City Council and you, Mayor, have not taken any steps to provide and protect to our community. Cities across the nation, including Atlanta, Akron, Ohio, Wilmington, Delaware, Seattle, and most recently Oakland, have signed on to the Ceasefire Now resolution. And I urge Long Beach City Council to join this growing list, to stand on the right side of history and demonstrate to your residents that you genuinely care for Palestinian Muslims and every ethnic.
Thank you.
Nothing at this moment holds greater importance than what's going on in Palestine. Right? And let me tell you, this process has taught me and my fellow Muslim and Arab brothers and sisters about political engagement. And this lack of support for Palestine motivates our people to run, and it motivates our people to vote in the city election that are already so low in voter turnout. We will not stop talking about Palestine. We will not stop advocating
Thank you.
For Palestine. And we will never, ever be silent.
Thank you. All right, thank you. Thank you. We're gonna proceed with the city council meeting. Thank you so much for your public comment today. All right. You know what? We're gonna call for a 5-minute recess. We'll be back in 5 minutes. Thanks. All right, folks. So thank you all for coming out. Once again, it is illegal to speak on anything not on the city council agenda. Our process. Our process is that when, hey, folks, I'm trying to make a statement and conduct official business, and we need to make sure that we're able to do that. Our process is to call a recess first. If we cannot restore order and have a conversation, like conduct business, the next step is to clear the room if we're not able to do that. Now, what I will tell you, you have a right to participate in the meeting. You have a right to show up to the meeting, but you have to allow us to conduct the meeting. I will also say, although it is not on the agenda tonight, it is on the agenda at the Equity and Human Relations Commission tomorrow. There is a discussion there about updating the language of the resolution. So that is on the agenda if you would like to speak to it there. So we need to get back to running, conducting the business of the meeting. That's what we need to do in this moment. So I'm gonna call the council members back now so that we can proceed with the city council meeting. You will not have us speak to that issue until it is on the city council agenda. You will not, that this isn't happening. This is not a back and forth. So thank you. So I'm gonna call the council members back to the room now so that we can begin to conduct order of the meeting. So Madam Clerk, let's call the council members back and we'll do roll call when we have a quorum.
If we can have the council members enter the chamber, please.
We're not doing a bullhorn here. We're not doing a bullhorn here. Okay. All right. We're not calling the council members back in here. All right. Thank you. We're going to now request that the room be cleared so we can begin the process of having the meeting. Thank you. Okay, Madam Clerk, we're calling back to order the meeting of the Long Beach City Council. Roll call, please.
Councilwoman Zendejas.
Present.
Vice Mayor Allen.
Present.
Councilmember Duggan.
Here.
Councilman Supernov.
Here.
Councilwoman Kerr.
Here.
Councilwoman Sorrow.
Present.
Councilmember Yuranga.
Presente.
Mayor Richardson.
I am here.
We have a quorum.
Okay, let's go to our first hearing, item 27, please.
Report from Economic Development, recommendation to receive supporting documentation into the record, conclude the public hearing and adopt a resolution continuing the Long Beach Tourism Business Improvement Area, districts 1, 2, 4, and 5.
Thank you, no oath is required. I'll pass it over to Mr. Modica.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I do wanna make one quick comment on this is, these are hearings, and so we will make sure the people who are here to testify for the hearing, if they're like the property or the owner will be here. There is nobody for number 27, but we will get somebody for number 28. So I will turn it over now to Bo Martinez, our Economic Development Director, to go through this.
Thank you, City Manager Modica. Bo Martinez, Director of Economic Development, and I'm gonna have our Business Development Bureau Manager, Julian Cernuda, who will give us an update on the item before you.
Thank you, Mayor and City Council. The Long Beach Tourism Business Improvement Area was established by the City Council in 2005, and it allowed for the levy of an annual assessment to be paid by the hotels with greater than 30 rooms located in the Tourism and Business Improvement Area. The city contracts with the Convention and Visitors Bureau to manage the Tourism and Business Improvement Area, and the Convention and the Visitors Bureau Board of Directors serves as the advisory board to the City Council on matters related to the area. Now, state law governing this district requires that an annual report be approved by the City Council, and the annual report attached to this item describes the boundaries, proposed activities, and budgetary information, as well as the method and basis for the continuation of the assessment. The annual report proposes no change to the area boundaries or the method of levying the assessment, and the proposed activities will focus on promoting and marketing Long Beach as a destination for tourists and conventions. The City Council shall hear and consider all protests from hotel operators against the assessment program and boundaries of the area as proposed in the annual report. And that concludes my staff report.
Thank you. And seeing no public comment, we'll take it back behind the rail. We need a motion and a second on this public hearing. Let's see, we have Councilmember Yuranga as a motion. Councilmember Yuranga, did you want to speak to this?
No.
Okay, Vice Mayor Allen?
No.
Okay, great. Members, please cast your vote.
Motion is carried.
Okay, we are going to set aside item 27, item 28, and go to item 29. We'll come back to item 28 when the person who's here to testify is identified. Oh, is this the right person? Great,
yes,
fantastic. All right, let's hear item 28.
Report from Financial Management, recommendation to receive the supporting documentation into the record, conclude the public hearing and grant an entertainment permit with conditions for entertainment without dancing to DiPiazza's Inc., District 4. There is an oath required for this item. If those who are testifying can please raise your right hand. Do you and each of you solemnly state that the testimony you may give in the cause now and pending before this body shall be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help you God? Thank you, maybe.
Yes.
All right, thank you, Mr. Modica.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Junie Salcido, for our Business Services Officer, will give the staff report.
Good evening, Honorable Mayor and members of the City Council. Before you tonight is an application for entertainment without dancing for DiPiazza's Inc., doing business as DiPiazza. The establishment is located at 5205 Pacific Coast Highway and currently operates as a restaurant and ready-to-eat food with alcohol. The business has an ABC license type 47 on sale general eating place, which allows for the sale of beer, wine, and distilled spirits for consumption on the premises. All appropriate departments, health and human services, development services, police and financial management have reviewed the application and have provided their recommended conditions as contained in the hearing packet. The following recommended condition in attachment A should be noted from the additional conditions section. One, entertainment activities shall be restricted to no later than 12 a.m. on Sunday through Thursday and 2 a.m. on Friday and Saturday. Entertainment can begin at 11 a.m. Monday through Sunday. Two, the permittee must provide all renters with a copy of the approved permit, which shall include a copy of their approved conditions of operation. Three, the permittee shall not convert the hall rental or any portion thereof into a public dance nightclub. All entertainment activities shall be restricted to private gatherings. The permittee shall not allow anyone to rent the hall for the purpose of holding a concert, dance, or disc jockey event, which is open to the public. I, along with Commander Shalina Benson from the Long Beach Police Department, are available to answer any questions that you may have. This concludes my staff report.
All right, thank you. We'll now go to public comment. We want to invite up our hearing applicant.
Hello, everybody. I'm Steve Guillen. I am a longtime business owner here, I had to make some changes, which opened this up here. And the only thing I have to say is that I've been a great supporter of this city, and I have great people around me, including you guys as well. So I just want to say thank you, and good luck to everybody.
Thank you. All right, that satisfies public comment. We'll now take it back behind the rail. Councilmember Supernaw.
I enthusiastically move this motion. I ask for my colleagues' support.
Councilmember Kerr.
Looking forward to supporting. Good to see you.
Great. All good things. Members, please cast your vote.
Councilwoman Duggan. Motion is carried.
All right, thank you. We'll go to item 29, please.
Report from City Manager, recommendation to authorize City Manager or designee to execute an agreement with the Public Corporation for the Arts of the City of Long Beach, DBA, the Arts Council for Long Beach, citywide.
All right, thank you. This is a good item. We're gonna go to staff, but beforehand, this is really important to have a public art and cultural assets inventory, particularly as we look ahead to the events in 2028, an opportunity to really highlight our city. And this has been an ongoing discussion about the need for a cultural inventory here in our city and our public arts inventory. So that said, I'll go to Mr. Modica for a brief presentation.
Thank you very much, Mr. Mayor. I think you said it really well. This is our annual agreement that we fund with the Arts Council, otherwise known as the Public Corporation for the Arts. So this includes the funding that they do to give grants out in our name to other cities, or I'm sorry, to other entities. And then also in the latest budget appropriation, we added some additional funds to do that comprehensive inventory. So they're a great partner. They've requested to come back maybe in a couple months to talk a little bit about the work that they've been doing to show the return on our investment in their organization. So that concludes our staff report.
Thank you. Council member, let's go to the motion. Let's see. Oops, wrong item. I'm still getting used to this thing. Okay, Council member Uranga.
Thank you, Mayor. My district has benefited from the Arts Council, and I'm very happy to support this.
Thank you. Vice Mayor Allen.
Very, very excited to support this.
Thank you, Council members and Dejas.
Thank you. Art is a reflection of life in all its beautiful and complex colors. I am proud to live in a city where we value and celebrate and support local artists, art organizations, and programs. As chair of the Arts, Culture, and Tourism Committee, I strongly support this item. Thank you.
All right. Thank you. Members, please cast your vote.
Motion is carried.
Thank you. We'll now go to item 30.
Report from City Manager, recommendation to authorize City Manager to amend contract with the Long Beach Museum of Art Foundation, citywide.
Thank you. Staff?
This is also an annual agreement that we do with our Museum of Art Foundation. They do an amazing job both caring for the city's art collection as well as the art collection that they have acquired over the years through other donations. So it is a city facility that then has a mixture of both private and public art. Every year we contract with them to have them care for that collection and do amazing programming for the city. So this is the annual contract and we're excited to present it to you.
All right, thank you. Seeing no public comment, members, please cast your vote.
Motion is carried.
Thank you. 42, please.
Report from City Manager, recommendation to continue the local emergency caused by conditions or threatened conditions of a network security incident targeting City of Long Beach systems and receive and file an update on the emergency proclamation citywide.
Thank you. Just a brief comment here. So tonight's action serves to continue the declaration of local emergency following the network security incident targeting the City of Long Beach that occurred November 14th. And the emergency is scheduled to sunset on December 19th. So this has been an unprecedented event for our organization that we take very seriously. And I am incredibly proud of our city team on its response thus far, our city management, our IT department. And while most systems are now restored, and we just announced the utility services coming back on, the investigation remains ongoing. The recovery process may take time, but we remain steadfast in our dedication to restoring all normal operations and ensuring the safety and security of our network, our systems, and our community. And we understand the importance of transparency and are committed to providing regular updates on our continued progress on these efforts. Now I'll pass it to city staff.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Leah Erickson can give a brief staff report.
Good evening, Honorable Mayor and members of the City Council. So I'm here to provide the update on that emergency proclamation as the mayor described. And the declaration of emergency was made due to the need for a swift emergency response to protect city systems, preserve operational capacity, and to be able to quickly respond as a workforce to a very dynamic situation. Cyber attacks against municipalities have seen a sharp increase in recent history. Since the COVID-19 pandemic, other municipalities have faced network security incidents, several of which have resulted in ransomware attacks and data breaches that put the safety of the public and property at risk, such as rendering city services unusable and publishing of sensitive personal data of residents and employees. In fact, this year, there are at least 80 other local governments that have been subjected to cyber attacks, and last year, there was close to 120 known cyber attacks on local governments. I'm now going to briefly report on the activities that have occurred during this emergency activation. First, the city activated its Emergency Operations Center and its Joint Information Center and continues to provide as much information as possible and prudent during the cybersecurity incident. The EOC convened 13 times to discuss interim operational changes and the status of the remediation and containment of the network security incident. The Joint Information Center launched a special website to provide updates and set up a call center to provide information to the public and issued now 9 press releases providing updates on the emergency situation to date. When the internet was proactively disabled by the city on November 15th, departments with the assistance of TID developed interim solutions to facilitate continued service to the public, including acceptance of in-person payments and processing payroll and accounts payable checks. TID staff continue to provide in-person and phone assistance along with support emails to ensure all city workers are able to access the network and to continue to provide city services for the community. To support the containment of the network security incident, TID, with the assistance of third-party cybersecurity professionals, have facilitated deployment of additional security technology to enhance threat detection and response in addition to monitoring the environment. To ensure only authorized people were accessing the city network, TID conducted a user account audit and forced a password reset of all the city's network users. The city also implemented stricter password requirements and a more rigorous multi-factor authentication process to strengthen the existing multi-factor authentication process that had previously been put in place. At this time, TID has a high level of confidence that the incident has been contained and any unauthorized user is no longer in the network. After containing the cyber incident, TID is now in the process of restoring internet connections and systems securely in a planned and sequential method to ensure systems function properly. The services are being brought online slowly, and there are several steps involved. As stated last week, most of our services have been restored, with utility billing being restored today. But the restoration work is still anticipated to continue for several days, and we hope that library digital services will resume later this week. I do want to note that once the systems are online, there still may be some backlogs and catch-up processes required to return to normal operations. On the investigation front, TID is working closely with a third-party cybersecurity professionals to conduct an extensive forensic investigation of the incident. The investigation is still working to identify the source and full scope of the incident and is in its earliest stages and could take several weeks or months before it is concluded. Due to the nature of the cybersecurity incident and active investigation, the information related to the investigation is confidential and the city cannot disclose specifics. The city, through the forensic investigation, can confirm at this time that there was no evidence of encryption activity, which is also known as ransomware in the network. In addition, the city determined an unauthorized party did acquire some of the city's data during this incident. The city is working with third-party cybersecurity professionals to determine the nature and scope of data that was taken. One primary objective of the investigation is to determine whether individuals' personal information was accessed and/or acquired as a result of the incident. Should the city determine personal information was compromised, the city will notify any affected individuals versus U.S. mail as soon as reasonably possible. Further, should the city discover that individual social security number was accessed and/or acquired, the city will provide credit monitoring services and other support to those individuals. The process of identifying specific individual sensitive information is incredibly detailed and will likely take many weeks to complete. The city will continue to provide regular updates as appropriate. We are now requesting City Council extend the emergency until December 19th, at which time it will sunset. The additional 2 weeks are needed to provide the emergency powers to complete the remainder of the digital services restorations and to allow for procurement and deployment of security technology solutions to further enhance detection, response, and monitoring of the environment. The full fiscal impact is unknown at this time and will be based on the work to identify the source and scope of the incident and the additional security measures. If the city manager utilizes purchasing authority under the emergency that exceeds normal levels, the city manager will bring those contracts to council at the next regularly scheduled agenda and report on the fiscal impact and budget solutions to address the expenditures as soon as possible. This concludes my report, and I stand ready to answer any questions. Thank you.
All right, thank you. And Madam Clerk, e-comment is available, is that correct?
That is correct for all items and non-agenda public comment for this evening. The public can go to the city clerk's website to provide e-comment.
Great, yeah, I wanna remind folks that we, due to disruptions, we needed to clear the room, but e-comment is available online through the end of the meeting. Thank you, members, please cast your vote.
Motion is carried.
Thank you, item 31.
Excuse me, Mayor. If we could revisit that last item briefly, we need to just amend the language slightly to have the council declare that the emergency will actually end on the 19th of December and not continue through the 19th of December.
I think that's what we can state that. So,
please. Yes.
I thought that was stated in the comments, but let's just go back and make sure that if you want to just read the motion and then we'll make sure the motion second agrees to that. So you want to restate the motion?
All right, so the motion will be recommend to continue the local emergency caused by conditions or threatened conditions of a network security incident targeting City of Long Beach systems, which if not corrected, constitutes an imminent and proximate threat to the safety of persons and property within the city, to terminate on December 19th, 2023. And receive and file an update on the emergency proclamation and associated activities and provide any additional direction to city staff regarding the emergency.
Great, and the mover was Vice Mayor Allen, and the seconder was Councilwoman Zendejas. Right, okay, I think we're good, unless you say we need to vote again.
Please vote again.
Okay, let's vote again.
Thank you.
Let's queue up the motion again. Motion by Vice Mayor Allen, second by Councilwoman Zendejas.
Because they're not.
Motion is carried.
Thank you. All right, we'll now go to item 31, please.
Communication from Councilmember Duggan. Recommendation to request city manager to work with the city attorney to return a city council to city council with a resolution requesting the President of the United States to expand the protected area of the San Gabriel Mountain foothills and rivers.
Thank you. Councilmember Duggan.
All right. The San Gabriel Mountains are an important part of the LA region, and I'm happy to bring this item forward for Long Beach to join the coalition of cities, nonprofit, and native tribes in asking for more of the Angeles National Forest to be included in the San Gabriel Mountain National Monument designation. I want to thank the mayor's office for starting this conversation and working with my office on this item. For some background, in 2014, President Obama declared 346,000 acres of the San Gabriel Mountains as a national monument. This brought more protections for the forest, more resources to make sure people were able to use this open space. Since 2014, the Nature for All Coalition, formerly known as the San Gabriel Mountains Forever, has continued to push for more of the Angeles National Forest to be included in the National Monument designation. This means extending protections to more of the National Forest and bringing additional resources to more of the San Gabriel Mountains so they can be enjoyed by more people for generations to come. The Nature for All Coalition's mission is to build a diverse base of support to ensure everyone in the LA area has equitable access to the wide range of benefits which nature provides. In 2021, Senator Padilla and Representative Chu authored bills advocating to expand the boundaries of the San Gabriel National Monument, and this initiative continues to gain momentum. As the chair of the Climate, Environment, and Coastal Protection Committee, I get to dive into a lot of interesting topics that protect or enhance our environment and open space. I think we've learned that once a piece of wilderness is gone, it's very hard to, sometimes impossible to bring back. The San Gabriel Mountains provides a third of the county's drinking water. It serves as a valuable nature for over 15 million people who live within 90-minute drive, and it's a resource that we need to protect. I move to approve the request for the city manager to work with the city attorney to return to city council with a resolution supporting the permanent protections of the San Gabriel Mountains foothills and rivers with federal designations and the use of presidential authority under the Antiquities Act within 60 days. Thank you so much.
All right, thank you. Seconder, Megan Kerr, Councilmember Kerr.
Happy to support.
Thank you, Councilwoman Sorrow.
Yes, thanks, Mayor. I completely support this item as someone who's worked for the San Gabriel and Lower LA Rivers Mountains Conservancy, doing exactly what Councilwoman Duggan has shared. In doing preservation and also creating access to recreational space to people in our urban area. I'm so glad that you brought this item forward so we can support it. And my service with the agency ends tomorrow, so that doesn't decrease my commitment. If anything, I'm always forever supportive of preserving our nature and our green space. Thank you.
Thank you, Councilmember Yaranga.
Thank you, Mayor, and thank you, Councilmember Duggan, for bringing this forward. As a member of that committee, as well as a member of the Rivers and Mountains Conservancy, I totally support this wholeheartedly. We do some great work in preserving our natural resources, and having this go forward for the expansion is wonderful news. Thank you.
Thank you. All right, members, please cast your vote.
Motion is carried.
Thank you. 32, please.
Report from Financial Management. Recommendation to adopt a resolution authorizing the city manager to execute a contract with TYMCO Inc. for the purchase of 2 Freightliner air vacuum sweeper trucks in a total amount not to exceed $1,037,409, including taxes and fees, citywide.
Thank you. Mr. Modica?
This is a pretty standard item to purchase vehicles. If you'd like a report from Dan, we can give one.
I think we're okay. It's been moved and seconded. Members, please cast your vote.
Motion is carried.
Thank you. Item 33.
Report from Financial Management. Recommendation to receive and file contracts made pursuant to Chapter 2.69 and 2.85 of the Long Beach Municipal Code and in response to the proclaimed emergency for homelessness citywide.
Thank you. We need a motion and a second. Okay, it's been moved and seconded. Mr. Modica, anything?
No, these are the contracts that we bring you as part of the emergency. You ratify them after the fact, and then we are going to have a larger discussion next week about homelessness. Great. And starting to look at ending the emergency on a date certain in February.
Great. Thank you. Members, please cast your vote.
Motion is carried.
Thank you. 34, please.
Report from Human Resources. Recommendation to adopt a resolution amending the city's salary schedules effective September 23rd, 2023 and October 7th, 2023, citywide.
All right, thank you. Moved and seconded. Mr. Modica, anything?
No staff report unless you request one.
Thank you. Members, please cast your vote.
Motion is carried.
Thank you. 35, please.
Report from Human Resources. Recommendation to adopt a resolution approving the 2023 to 2026 Memorandum of Understanding with the Association of Engineering Employees citywide.
All right. Thank you. So this is important. We know that that our hardworking engineers are incredibly important as we chart more investment into our infrastructure in the future. And so we are proud that the City Council has an opportunity here to vote to approve this agreement, this three-year agreement with our city employees that really prioritizes the value of their service to the community. Mr. Modica?
Yeah, we can give a brief staff report. I think you mentioned that very well. I'll turn to Sandra to talk through some of the just high-level components.
Honorable Mayor and City Council, the City and the Association of Engineering Employees successfully worked together to reach a tentative agreement regarding changes in wages, hours, and other terms and conditions of employment for the 217 employees in this bargaining unit. A primary focus during these negotiations for both parties was to identify certain positions that were compensated below the market compared to other similar public agencies and apply an equity increase to help bring those positions close to market rate. This approach not only supports fair compensation for retention purposes, but also helps in future recruitment efforts for these specific positions. Thank you to both our city departments and the AEE negotiations team for their work and support for this agreement. As a result of the tentative agreement, a successor memorandum of understanding has been reached, which is before you this evening for adoption. This concludes my presentation, and I am available to answer any questions. Thank you.
All right, thank you. Okay, it's been moved and seconded. Members, please cast your vote.
Motion is carried.
Thank you. 37, please.
Item 37, report from Public Works. Recommendation to authorize city manager to execute all documents necessary to amend multiple contracts for providing as needed architectural services for a revised aggregate contract amount not to exceed $21.5 million citywide.
Okay, thank you. It's been moved and seconded. Members, please cast your vote.
Motion is carried.
Thank you. 38, please.
Report from Public Works. Recommendation to authorize city manager to execute all documents to amend contract with Laz Parking California for citywide parking operations and management services for a revised contract amount not to exceed $41.4 million citywide.
It's been moved and seconded. Members, please cast your vote.
Motion is carried.
Thank you. Item 39, please.
Report from Public Works. Recommendation to increase appropriations in the Tidelands Operations Fund in the Public Works Department by $25 million to fund capital improvements at the Long Beach Convention and Entertainment Center as identified in the Elevate 28 Infrastructure Investment Plan, District 2.
Thank you. And before we hand it to staff, I'll just state that this is big. This is the first in a series of exciting infrastructure investments that we'll be making over the next 5 years as part of our Elevate 28 plan. And as we prepare to host more conventions and more events in 2028 and welcome the world to Long Beach, this allows us to begin by making some important and historic investments into our convention center. And so we look forward to kicking off this project and there's significant investment not only into our downtown but across our whole city, but this is sort of our opening volley. That said, we'll go to Mr. Modica.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Well said. This is a historic investment in our convention center. I think it's the largest that we've made since the big expansion in the 90s. We know we have an amazing convention center, and it brings a lot of economic generation to the city, but it's important that that asset be maintained. And there are some very large capital projects needs at the building a lot of these systems are coming to the end of their useful life. And so our team has really been focused on how do we make sure that building can continue to be an economic driver, and at the same time we are investing in a solar power system that is going to help reduce the footprint and also generate some energy savings as well. So you're going to hear a presentation right now from our team, and it'll cover both items 39 and 36 as they're related. We'll take up 39 first and get authorization to do the work, and then we'll entertain number 36, which has to do with the solar array. I will turn to Eric Lopez, our Director of Public Works, to give their staff report.
Thank you, City Manager, Mayor, members of the City Council. Bo Martinez, our Economic Development Director, will actually start, and then I'll talk a little bit about the facility needs and the initial investments, and then Kevin Riper will talk about how we're paying for all of this. Bo.
Thank you, Eric. Mayor, City Council, Bo Martinez, Director of Economic Development. For those of you who attended the recent tree lighting event and the recent announcement of the International Hard Rock Hotel, you know what a jewel our center is for not only the city of Long Beach, but also how it impacts our local and regional economy and to our vibrant downtown. As most of you know, some of the recent investments we made at the Long Beach Convention and Entertainment Center, including improvements to the arena seating, ADA and safety items, the City of Long Beach is the owner in trust for this wonderful facility. You're also probably aware that the center is a critical driver for tourism within the city, hosting a wide range of conventions, trade shows, performance, and sporting events. The economic impact to our tourism, hotel, retail, and restaurant partners, especially in our downtown and adjacent neighborhoods, as well as throughout the city, is over $1 billion annually. The success of the center is a partnership between the city, our operator ASM Global, and the Long Beach Convention and Visitors Bureau has resulted in repeated awards and recognitions for many years. As we were here last month, the center has won the prestigious Gold Award for the best center in the West for an unprecedented sixth year in a row. An important aspect of growing the Long Beach Initiative is the focus on increasing key business sectors throughout the city, including tourism, hospitality, entertainment sector, the creative economy, like I like to call it. We see a development of new hotels in downtown to support growth and increase opportunity. We know from the recent data that Long Beach continues to improve its position as a tourist and convention center destination. In 2022, even on the heels of the pandemic, the Long Beach Convention and Entertainment Center recorded business attendance of over 920,000 people. In 2023, The center set attendance record has increased those numbers to over 1 million attendees, and we continue to see a lot of growth and development interest at the center. Interest is increasing at the center and throughout our vibrant and emerging downtown. We are preparing to play host to the events for the 2028 Olympic Games, so it's vital to ensure that the center is not only important, but is also impeccable condition to support the games and position the center for long-term future service of the community and to our downtown and our retail, restaurants, and hospitality and tourism sectors. The last major expansion of the center was back in 1994. At the time, the center expanded convention center exhibit space to attract larger conventions and trade shows. Since that time, the city has also invested in creative design, use of the spaces that help the center continue to stay at the forefront of innovation and to compete nationally and internationally for business. Because we know that the convention center business is very competitive and we need to stay innovative and creative as we move forward. However, many of the building components such as the roof, mechanical systems, which provide heating, air circulation, and cooling to the center, are original to construction. And now we're sharing, they are all showing signs of deterioration and aging. It's essential that these systems are updated so that way we can continue to compete and keep the center modernized, innovative, and creative as we look to, you know, attract more business to the center. Now I'd like to turn it over to Eric Lopez, who's gonna now share with you some of the center's more specific needs as we move forward.
Thank you, Bo. In 2020, we did a citywide facility conditions assessments. The convention center complex was one of the many buildings around the city that we evaluated to determine the needs for capital improvement and deferred maintenance. Our findings were that a lot of the systems at the center are original. They have exceeded their useful life and they're in dire need of replacement, including the HVAC systems, some of the plumbing systems, the air handlers, etc. Some of the conveyance systems like elevators and stairways were also reviewed and are determined to be in need of improvement. We were also, throughout the years, we've been working on repairing the solar system at the convention center. We've had a couple partnerships there, and we also are proposing to redo the agreement and move forward with some solar panel installations while we're there making some of the roof improvements. So there is a power purchase agreement, an adjoining item number 36 here that will allow us to install a modern state-of-the-art solar panel installation that will help us generate 2,800 kilowatts of photovoltaics power from the center rooftop. So we've maximized, we work really hard to, as we're installing the brand new roofs and we're installing a amazing solar system, this facility will be more green, more sustainable than it has ever has been, and thus helping us reduce greenhouse gas emissions. So we are looking forward to our partnership with Volta to make these improvements upon all the roof repairs that are needed. The roofs are original. We've already added a few layers as part of maintenance, so we're at the point of needing to do a more complete roof improvement project, and that's part of the work that we would fund initially. There we will get to a portion of the roofs that require major repair. There are going to be additional roofs in the future that we will need to address, but for the current scope of work, the roof repairs are a major part of it. We're also looking for making some substantial ADA improvements and making some improvements to the HVAC systems and the air handlers. Those are the three priorities that we're going to be focused on. Bo mentioned a lot of the front of house improvements that happened over the last decade. Areas like the Pacific Ballroom, the Cove, the Seaside Way Rainbow Bridge. There's been a lot, Bogards, there's been a lot of investment in the front of house. So the work that we're proposing in the next couple years is a lot of back of house components that are in dire need of improvements. The life span of most of the improvements will be 30 years, so consistent with the length of the proposed funding strategy. So I'm going to turn this over to Kevin to talk about the bonds.
Thank you, Eric. Kevin Riper, Finance Director. Eric talked about two groups of $25 million each of improvements to the Convention and Entertainment Center. We are already scheduled as part of your long-term CIP program and Elevate 28. We are already scheduled to sell bonds in the spring of 2025, another $50 million. Recall that you authorized the sale of bonds in the spring of 2023 in the amount of $60 million for the long-term CIP program. Well, the next tranche is 2 years later, and the staff recommendation for this long-lived asset that is being improved, the staff recommendation is to add $25 million to that spring 2025 bond issue and pay the debt service on that, which is about $1,650,000 a year at current interest rates, with a combination of Tidelands Fund revenue, mostly Measure B transient occupancy tax that is already dedicated to the Convention and Entertainment Center. We're not asking you tonight to approve a bond sale. That won't happen until March or April of 2025. But we're previewing for you the long-term recommended strategy for financing this first $25 million of Convention and Entertainment Center improvements. And then 2 years after that, spring of 2027, we would sell the third and final tranche of Measure A infrastructure improvement bonds and recommend add $25 million to that for the second $25 million of Convention and Entertainment Center capital improvements. And again, we would come to you in the spring of 2027 to approve that bond sale. I mentioned the annual debt service on 30-year bonds at current interest rates. And I gotta say, current interest rates can change between now and 2025. One hopes they go down so that debt service would be a little less than $1.65 million, but there's always the possibility of interest rates going up, in which case the numbers on the slide will change. We don't sell the bonds until the spring of 2025, and debt service doesn't begin until the next fiscal year, or FY26. And then on the slide, I already mentioned the TOT revenue for Measure B of $1 million. The energy cost savings that Eric described a minute ago should be able to contribute $450,000 of annual savings in energy costs that could be redirected toward debt service, and then some other parking revenues available to make up the full $1,650,000. Because we're not selling the bonds until the spring of 2025 under the current schedule, but the improvements need to get underway right now, the staff recommendation is the Public Works Department use existing cash in the Tidelands Operating Fund, of which there's a sufficient amount to fund up front until we sell the bonds and reimburse ourselves the $25 million of first round of improvements. And that concludes our collective staff report. Prepare to answer any questions.
Thank you. We'll take it back behind the rail. Thanks for that. I just want to start with when we get to that second round, we're going to be doing the seats, right? Is that including the second $25 million?
The seats. Actually, the seats arena? Are already funded. So if you remember, the ASM has right. contributed $7 million back into the building. We are using that to redo all the seats that came to council a little while ago. Right. So that's already done. The next tranche will still be additional HVAC and ADA. It's about a $50 million project total.
Okay, and what's in that? Oh, so all the back of the house is about $50 million.
Correct, and then there's okay. another $7 million investment in infrastructure and the seats and a number of other things at the center.
Now the elevators, did I miss that? Was that included in this?
Elevators and escalators are included in
okay,
this tranche.
Great. Yeah, that's important. We want to make sure that those work. A lot of the conventions ask about that. But I think between this and the seats, it's a big opportunity for us. I would love to see with, now that we have the seats and we have this going on, how we can bring some new life to the arena. Particularly, it's got some great history in the arena, and there's a whole renaissance with old music facilities now. We've seen what's happening with the Forum, and people are reactivating it. I think once we invest some resources there, we may be able to generate more opportunities to bring some concerts back to the arena in the interim. So I think that's a really exciting opportunity for us. Councilwoman Zendejas.
Thank you, Mayor. Our convention center is a revenue-generating city asset that supports city-wide services while at the same time bringing much-needed business to our small businesses citywide. So very happy to see this item come through. I'm very pleased that this is part of our Elevate 28 plan and that we're able to prioritize funding for the critical capital improvement improvements in our convention center. I want to thank the team for being creative on how to find funds to fund these much, much needed improvements. Thank you for all your hard work that you've done on this.
Thank you. Vice Mayor Allen.
I concur with everything Mary said. She said it very well. So thank you.
Thank you. Next, we have Councilwoman Saro.
Yes, I'll add my comment as part of a member of the Economic Development and Opportunity Committee that very supportive well of this very critical capital improvement, and really grateful for all the work taken in thinking about how do we fund this to making it feasible and ensuring that we're meeting our city's goal becoming greener to be more energy efficient, as well as ensuring that we're economically thriving city as well. So thank you.
Thank you. That satisfies council comment. Members, please cast your vote.
And Mayor, if I can make one addition, the agenda talks about this in District 2. That was way back when. It's actually in District 1. So we'd like the record to reflect that.
Thank you. All right, members, please cast your vote.
Motion is carried.
36, please.
Report from Public Works, recommendation to authorize city manager to execute all documents necessary for an amended and restated power purchase agreement with VS Long Beach Solar One, District 2.
Thank you, and this was already covered in the last presentation?
Correct.
Correct, so this is the solar power element to our convention center. So it's been moved and seconded. Members, please cast your vote.
Motion is carried.
Thank you. Item 40, please.
Report from City Attorney, recommendation to declare attached ordinance amending the Long Beach Municipal Code relating to municipal elections read and adopted as read citywide.
Thank you. It's been moved and seconded. Members, please cast your vote. This is second reading.
Motion is carried.
Thank you. Item 41.
Communication from Councilwoman Saro, recommendation to increase appropriations in the general fund group in the city manager department by $500, offset by the 6th Council District one-time priority funds to provide contributions to Kahlo Creative.
Thank you. It's been moved and seconded. Members, please cast your vote.
Motion is carried.
Thank you. Again, for general public comment two, we have e-comment since the city council meeting was interrupted. We'll now go to adjournments and announcements, and we'll start with Councilmember Uranga.
Thank you, Mayor. I would like to close, I would like to close this meeting in memory of the life of Fontana Mesagera. Mesagera, born in Phnom Penh, Cambodia on December 15, 1968. Lan Nam was the second of five children, two Mayas Nam and Suan Hing. Fleeing the Khmer Rouge, the Mayas family found refuge in the U.S. in 1975, settling in Long Beach. Lan Nam's educational career or journey took her from Willard Elementary to Wilson High School, culminating a bachelor's degree in biological sciences for the University of California, Irvine in 1991. Her commitment to healthcare led her to the University of San Francisco, where she earned a Bachelor of Science in Nursing in 1994, obtaining certifications as a registered nurse and public health nurse in 1995. On the side, those are two very important, very difficult certificates to receive. So that was quite a phenomenal accomplishment for her. For 30 years, Lan Nam served with dedication at St. Mary's Hospital in Long Beach, primarily in the pediatric department. It was here that she met her husband, Greg Guerra. Their 20-year love story was sparked by a note with words from Anne Rice, which I will quote later. Lan Nam passed away on November 24th, 2023, leaving behind a legacy of love and compassion. To her family, she was an affectionate daughter, sister, and aunt. To her colleagues, a dedicated and caring nurse. Her love for the outdoors and infectious laughter and Mala's energy defined her character. As we bid farewell to Lanlap, Maz Guerra, may her memories inspire us to embrace compassion and joy, giving away the spirit, keeping alive the spirit she shared with all who had the privilege of knowing her. With that, I would like to conclude with these words from Anne Rice, novelist Anne Rice. Move on believing in love, in peace, and harmony, and in great accomplishment. Remember, joy isn't a stranger to you. You are winning and you are strong. Love, love first, love always, love forever.
Thank you so much for those words. Now, also adjourn tonight's meeting in honor of James Nash, a 30-year member of Directors Guild of America, a former senior staff director at CBS TV, and was a dedicated member of the board of directors at the Arts Council for Long Beach. James' numerous honors included 12 Emmy Awards, 10 Golden Mics from the Radio Television Digital News Association, and 10 Best Directors Awards from the Associated Press Television Radio Association. James attended Whittier College, the University of Copenhagen, and Claremont Graduate School. He had a lifelong love of music and played contrabass with the brass with the World Stage Jazz Orchestra and with Los Angeles St. Petersburg Russian Folk Orchestra. So we adjourn tonight's meeting in honor of James. Next we have Suli Sorrow.
Yes, we are going to have our District 6, last District 6 community update on on economic development with special guests from our LBPD West Division on holiday safety tips, as well as our meet and greet with our new executive director of Midtown PBID, Avis Atkins. That's going to be Thursday, December 7th from 5:30 to 7 p.m. at Mark Twain Library.
All right, Councilman. Councilwoman Kerr.
Yes, we lost some incredible people in our community recently, and tonight I ask that we adjourn in the memory of B.I. Mays, Bill B.I. Mays, who passed away recently at the age of 92. B.I. was born and raised in Long Beach and was among St. Anthony High School's most notable alumni, where he was the school's football star. As the quarterback, B.I. led the Saints to their only CIF championship in history, winning against Santa Barbara High School in 1948 at the L.A. Coliseum. After graduating from St. Anthony, Bill continued to stay involved in his alma mater's community, dedicating himself to supporting the school whenever he could. Not only did the school hold memories of great athletic success, but it's where his love story began as well. Bill and his wife of 60 years were high school sweethearts before starting their family and raising 7 children together. Throughout his life, Bill and his family supported St. Anthony in many ways. He headed the legendary Saints campaign to raise funds to replace the gymnastics floor. He sponsored students in need of financial aid every year. He attended countless events and fundraisers to show his support whenever his school needed it most. And most recently, Bill and his family supported the building of a new athletic complex at Clark Field. The Mays family attended the dedication and ribbon cutting ceremony on the new field, which was doubly special for B.I. as he used to practice and play on the original field there. Outside his clear passion for his alma mater, B.I. was a positive, illuminating force to all who knew him. He continued his career as quarterback at Cal Berkeley in 51 and 52. He served in the Army, had a 30-year career at IBM, and a second career doing investment advisory for 30 years. He was an inspiration to all who knew him. He was known to be kind, loving, and warm, and friends will remember the infectious smile that lit up the room every time he walked in. He was a family man, a hard worker, and gave back to the communities and institutions he believed in. His legacy will live on, not only at St. Anthony, but in the hearts and minds of all who knew him. And we take this moment to thank him for his positive influence on our community and express our sincere condolences to the friends, families, and loved ones he's left behind. May he rest in peace, and go Saints.
Thank you, Councilwoman Zendejas.
First of all, condolences to those that we are closing the meeting for today. Today, I'd like to invite you to our third annual District 1 holiday party happening on Wednesday, December 13th, 2023 from 6:30 p.m. to 8 p.m. at the Westin Hotel. For more information, please visit please email district1@longbeach.gov. I also want to invite you to our Northeast Village annual toy giveaway, Saturday, December 16, 2023, from 12 p.m. to 2 p.m. This event will take place at Gumbinder Park. For more information, please email district1@longbeach.gov. I also am so proud to be sponsoring our annual Winter in Wilmore celebration. This event will take place on Saturday, December 16th, 2023, from 3 p.m. to 7 p.m. at the Bembridge House. For more information, please email wilmorecity@gmail.com. Thank you.
All right. Thank you, Councilmember Uranga.
Thank you, Mayor. I also want to remind people that this coming Saturday at dusk, we will be having our annual Daisy Lane Parade in the 7th District in City of Long Beach. So you're all welcome to join us. Please enjoy the floats, the bands, and our dignitaries who are here behind me, with me here. Hopefully they will be attending. Thank you.
Thank you, Councilwoman Kerr.
Yes, just a couple of announcements of community events. I invite all residents to attend Parkview Village's second Saturday Holiday Fest this Saturday, December 9th from 12 to 4 at 5423 East Village Road. You can support local businesses and fair trade artisans by shopping small this holiday season. Join in the celebration and a day of community. And then on Sunday, December 10th from 1 to 5, dress up as your favorite holiday character and join the Bixby Knowles Business Improvement Association at SantaCon. With live music, holiday shopping, food and drink specials all along the beer crawl, it's a perfect activity to get into the holiday spirit with friends and neighbors, and there are things for kids to do as well. You can see the BKBIA to purchase tickets. In the spirit of giving, I invite you to donate to Cal Heights Music's Toy Drive to benefit Miller Children's Hospital. You can bring a new unwrapped toy or gift to the donation bin at 1240 East Wardlow Road, and you'll be rewarded with a Cal Heights Music holiday sticker. And they're accepting donations between now and December 22nd. And Saturday the 16th, there'll be a toy, Love in the Mirror toy giveaway at Long Beach City College on Carson Street from 12 to 3. Thank you.
Thank you, Vice Mayor Allen.
Yes, I'd like to invite everyone to the District 2 Winter Wonderland and Discover LBCC event on December 16th at Orizaba Park. It's from 11 to 3, and we're going to transform that park into a winter wonderland with 4,000 square feet of snow on the ground, and we'll also be blowing snow in the air so you can put your tongue out and enjoy it. Free food, music, toy drive, resources. I hope Councilman Sorrow is bringing your kids because, you know, it's a great place to come and, enjoy the snow here in Long Beach. So I hope you all can make it.
Thank you, Councilmember Supernaw.
Thank you. I'd like to thank Councilman Kerr for that wonderful tribute to B.I. Mays. Our condolences to the entire Mays family, and that includes his oldest son, Mike Mays, who was our longtime assistant city attorney for the city of Long Beach. There is a memorial service on Saturday, December 9th at 10 a.m. at St. Joseph Catholic Church at Willow and Palo Verde in the 4th District. Thank you.
All right, thank you. That satisfies the city council meeting. Thank you so much for participating this evening. Have a good night. This meeting is adjourned.